Really interesting diet trial just came out looking at precision nutrition. This idea of trying to figure out the right diet for each individual, which is a really exciting field. We know many different dietary patterns can deliver benefits. For example, many trials look at low carb versus low fat. And typically you see similar weight loss and metabolic improvements in the long run. We also know different people do better on different diets. We see that in the evidence in these trials when they show data for individual participants. And we get that feedback in the comments every single day. Some viewers say a low-fat diet saved them and they feel like they're 20 again. Others say a low-fat diet almost killed them. And the same story for low-carb and whole food plant-based and everything in between. So we already know it's not one size fits all. The mystery has been, what explains this variation? Why do some people do better on diet A and others on diet B? Is it habit? Is it personal preference? Is it genetics? This is the next frontier of nutrition, figuring out these individual variabilities, and I think we'll see this blow up in the next decade or two. So this new trial tries to shed some light on this. They took over 200 volunteers, all overweight, and split them randomly between two diets with same amount of calories, but different fat content. On one diet, people got 34% of their calories from fat, and on the other one, 28%. Initially, the researchers were shooting for a bigger gap, 10% of fat difference between the two groups. But this is what typically happens in these trials. The participants fall short of the goal. Now, I know some viewers like to eat 5% of their calories from fat, and others like to eat 85%. And depending on your preference, you might think both of these diets are low fat, or both are high fat. So we'll just call them lower and higher fat relative to each other, and we'll just get the semantics out of the way. Okay, what was the fat replaced with? Protein. Protein was a bit higher on the lower fat diet. Often in nutrition trials, they try to keep protein constant because protein content can affect satiation and overall caloric intake. But here they decided to vary it. In reality, many different types of food and nutrient can affect satiation. Fat can do it, fiber can do it, etc. So anyway, this is what they decided to do. Let's see what happens with the results. Before that, there was one other difference between the diets. Fiber. The higher fat diet was a bit under 30 grams of fiber a day, and the lower fat diet was a bit over 30 grams. This difference in fiber was achieved with a supplement of beta-glucan, which is a type of fiber you find, for example, in some grains like oats and barley. I know some viewers will wonder, why use supplements? Why not eat the actual foods? And in general, that's probably a better approach. But in the context of the experiment, the supplement allows you to add fiber without changing the calories between the two groups. Also easier to quantify it, because it's a capsule, and easier to keep track of who took it and who didn't. So it's just a cleaner experiment, and I suspect that's why they used it. Other than that, the carbohydrates were kept constant. In both groups, they got about 44% of their calories from carbohydrate. One last thing. They were trying to do these tweaks with the macronutrients while staying within the dietary recommendations. This study was conducted in the Netherlands, so it was Dutch food guidelines, but they're generally similar everywhere. So the fat they added to the higher fat diet was monounsaturated fat from things like olive oil and olives. And they kept both polyunsaturated and saturated fat constant at about 8% of calories each, give or take. So the higher fat diet had more olive oil and more olives and things like that. And the lower fat diet had a bit more low-fat dairy, like low-fat cheese or yogurt. And they kept the participants on these diets for 3 months. So what were the results? They looked for improvements in a number of metabolic parameters. Things like fasting insulin, glucose and insulin levels after a meal, triglyceride levels, and also some markers of inflammation. Some people improved those metrics on the lower fat diet and some on the higher fat diet, which is already interesting because it points against this idea that diet X is ideal for humans, and if you're not on that, you're a fool. But the plot thickens because they suggest some possible explanations for the individual variability. And this was the interesting part. They estimated the participants' insulin resistance at baseline before the trial started. Insulin resistance is when your cells don't respond normally to insulin, and so they resist taking up glucose from circulation. Now, the interesting thing is insulin resistance is not one uniform characteristic across your body. You can be, for example, insulin resistant in your liver, but your muscle tissue is still relatively insulin sensitive. So you can be kind of like a mosaic. So they estimated the participants' insulin resistance in the muscle and in the liver. The participants that had insulin resistance predominantly in the liver did better on the higher fat diet. Several of those metabolic parameters improved, while on the lower fat diet, there was no significant change. But the people with muscle insulin resistance, it was the other way around. They saw improvement on the lower fat diet and no significant change on the higher fat. The authors speculate on why, the mechanistic reasons. Maybe there are changes to the microbiome. Maybe the unsaturated fat is particularly beneficial for liver function, and so it's good for people with liver insulin resistance. But this part is more speculative, it's in the discussion portion of the paper. So the mechanistic reasons are TBD. Another interesting thing is, if you remember, calorie intake didn't differ significantly between the two groups. And in fact, the changes didn't seem to be explained by overall weight loss. There was a small weight loss of about 2% of body weight in both the people that saw improvements and the ones that didn't. So weight loss per se didn't seem to explain the individual variability. As for fat loss, loss of actual fat tissue, there was a trend for fat loss to explain some of the differences, but it didn't reach statistical significance. And visceral fat, fat around and inside the organs, also didn't appear significantly different. On the other hand, something called gynoid fat, which is fat accumulated in the hips, the thighs, and the chest or breasts, so a more typical female pattern of accumulation, did differ significantly. The groups that saw the metabolic improvement also saw a bit more loss of the gynoid fat. So for example, people with muscle insulin resistance lost a bit more gynoid fat on the lower fat diet and also saw those metabolic improvements on that diet. And vice versa for liver insulin resistance. A bit less gynoid fat and a bit better metabolic markers on the higher fat diet. These differences in gynoid fat were very small, so we don't want to overclaim, but it's possible they play a role. And like we said, there was no statistically significant difference in reported calorie intake or overall body weight. So this suggests a change in body composition, a redistribution of body mass. Okay, so what does this all mean? Should we all go measure our insulin resistance in a bunch of different organs and make our shopping lists accordingly? Not so fast. This is the part where I pump the brakes. If you're a regular viewer, you already know we don't bet the farm on single studies. Science moves incrementally. Rarely does it progress by whiplash, unlike what social media would have us believe. In fact, the authors themselves point to some caution, and as we were just getting ready to shoot, Kevin Hall, who is a world leader in these metabolic studies, was pointing out to me some more reservations that he has. So as always, we take individual studies with a big grain of salt, with skepticism, and if the results get replicated, then our confidence level goes up. Precision nutrition is really in its infancy, so all the details are yet to be worked out. But of course, the hype train is already miles ahead. You see people all over the internet selling programs and tests to determine your dietary profile and your personal microbiome, which is going to tell you lots of things about your health. Whenever you hear really confident, absolute claims about this, get your guard up, especially if there's something for sale, because the science is just not there yet. Always ask for the evidence. If the findings of this study turn out to be the real deal, it will add scientific substance to something we see on a daily basis, that the right diet for you might not be the same as for the next guy. If you tried diet XYZ and it didn't work, it doesn't necessarily mean you did something wrong. Or maybe there's something wrong with me because it worked for my cousin. Maybe the diet is wrong for you. As the authors say, they found a greater effectiveness of precision nutrition over a one-size-fits-all approach within the diet guidelines. I think in 10 or 20 years, we'll probably have rapid tests, maybe with a drop of blood, kind of like that Theranos thing, but the non-scam version, the version that actually works. And it'll tell us, based on your genome and metabolome, here's the dietary pattern that's most likely to work for you. And by the way, you don't have that high susceptibility to lung cancer, but watch out for Alzheimer's. So here are the factors you got to focus on. Welcome to the future. Last but not least, I love that they designed their menus with more or less fat, more or less protein, but all healthy dietary patterns. This is really crucial, finding that sweet spot between individual preference and the science on long-term health. You don't need to sacrifice heart health or cancer risk in the future to lose weight today. You can get the best of both worlds. For more on insulin resistance and diabetes, check out this video. And here's one on common weight loss myths. I'll catch you next week.